So, I'm talking to you about the game Zero K. This is an online strategy game that I've been developing for the last few years. And one
Sorry, we have a problem with the screen sharing.
What is the problem?
In my window, the screen is only visible partly. Is this true for all the others?
Can't you maximize it?
Can you see every... let me see. Okay. All right. So now it's better. Okay. Sorry.
Okay.
My fault. I hadn't arranged the windows properly. Please carry on.
Yeah. So this is about implementing a rating system for an online strategy game. And to get it started, I thought maybe we could use the chat a bit more to interact. So I'm sure many of you guys have played online competitive games before. So could you just write into chat what kind of games you've played? And that's a great example. Yeah, I see already CSGO, chess, StarCraft. These all have ratings that we will see here later. I don't exactly know how to... the OZU rating, we will also see something similar. And yeah, let's just get into it. So you've probably seen that when you played these games, there were some problems with the ratings. There's always something that doesn't work quite as what you want it to. So I will define some base guidelines that a rating system should follow. So firstly, it should predict game outcomes without bias. This means it doesn't matter how you play a game. It should always reward winning strategies, no matter how they are done. Secondly, it should adapt to skill changes. This sounds a bit trivial, but many times when you play these games, you think, I've already improved so much, but the rating system for some reason doesn't let me improve. So people start creating new accounts to just to improve their rating, and the rating system should adapt for that for them. As the next point, they should account for rating uncertainty. This means when you're a new player or you're a really inconsistent player, the rating system doesn't know how well you play, and this should be reflected in the formulas. And lastly, probably one of the most important points is to deal with initial skill. This means when you get into a game as a new player, you will probably have some kind of pre-assigned rating. And this should not allow you to drag down other players' ratings because you play better than this assigned rating or worse than this assigned rating. The rating system should be able to estimate this initial skill. By the way, I just saw Baskar mentoring Portal in the chat, and that's not a competitive game, I think. Anyway, so let's get to the rating systems. So firstly, we have point-based ratings. I think OZU has something in that direction, but not a competitive OZU player, so I can't say for sure. These games, they take your performance in the game, assign points based on that performance, and then rate the players. This is usually really precise, but it can be played because the developers decide what are good actions in the game and what are bad actions in the game. So yeah, because it's not biased, it's definitely not something we want to use. Then we have ELO. This is probably what Hipmeier was referring to with chess, because everybody there uses ELO. ELO just gives a certain amount of change in the rating depending on how high the win chance of a game was, but it doesn't depend whether somebody's a new player or an old player, and it doesn't keep uncertainty. There are some fixes for the ELO system that are usually used in chess clubs because these issues are known. Yeah, but inherently ELO has these problems. So then what is often used in games like StarCraft or CSGO is a rating system based on Glico or Tuskell. These weighting systems, they add an uncertainty number to the weighting, and this uncertainty starts high for new players, meaning that the new players can change their weighting more quickly. But this still doesn't account for completely for new players being above or below average skill. So as a new player, you can still drag down other players. Then there are static weighting systems, like Elostat or Bayesian Elo. What these do is they take the entire history of weighting and try to assign one weighting for a player over all the games that the player has played that optimizes the Elo for this player. This can deal very well with initial skill and can find the uncertainty of a player, but it doesn't adapt to skill changes because it always looks at all the games. There's an easy fix for this called decayed history algorithms, and what they do is they just take the last 1,000 or 100 games and only calculate the weighting based on these games, or they use a weighting formula that decays with time. And what we will look at is whole history weighting, which is really similar to the decayed history, but has some advantages over it, in that it always looks at the whole history and not just the most recent history, as it is in the name. So now let's I just saw the comment that Lichas uses Glico. So not Elo. So for static weightings, let's first see how Bayesian Elo works. This is a basic weighting system that is like the precursor to whole history weighting. And we will use in this presentation most of the time not the Elo weighting, but natural weighting and player strength, because it's easier to calculate. Natural weighting is the same as Elo weighting, except for a constant that you multiply and add. And player strength is just the exponential of that. So how do we find out what is the win chance for a game? This is the Bradley-Terry model, or also what many people know as the chess formula. It's really the player strength of a player divided by the player strength of the player plus the enemy player. It's really simple and gives you the likelihood of a game happening, game outcome happening. Now, if we have an FFA game, and it's really similar, we just add up all of the enemies, add up all of their player strength, and then we get the chance of winning an FFA game. And now the third case, which is the most general case, is where we have teams of players. So we have teams of arbitrary size, and these teams play against each other, and we want to find out what is the chance that this game happened. So what we first do is we need to assign a strength to each team. We do this by taking the average. So you can see we take the average of the weightings and then use that as the rating of the team and use the previous formula again using these ratings. Should be pretty straightforward. So now, how can we use this to calculate the ratings? We want to find the likelihood distribution over the ratings, and we do that using Bayesian inference. You've probably seen this before. So we have the likelihood of the games happening times the prior divided by a normalization constant. And we only want to find the maximum likelihood where the derivative is zero. So we can ignore the normalization constant as usually. And to make the prior as simple as possible, we simply add two more games, one win and a loss against a player of rating zero. By the way, if you guys have any questions during the presentation, feel free to write into the chat. Okay, now we have the prior, and we can calculate this likelihood distribution. So how do we find the maximum? We use Newton's method. Why Newton's method? Because the likelihood distribution is a Gaussian, or very close to a Gaussian. So the derivative, the log likelihood, is a square function, so we can find the minima using Newton's method in just one iteration. Yeah, we then get this iterative formula where we calculate for every player. We keep all the other players constant, so we can calculate the derivatives easily. and then do one Newton iteration for that player and do that for all players. And if we keep repeating that, we get the maximum likelihood for all players. And since we've already gotten the second derivative of the log likelihood, we also know the uncertainty. We do that by just taking the inverse. You've seen this before. Now, just to prove you that this approximation of the Gaussian is correct, I calculated the likelihood distribution for myself using static ratings. So you can see here in blue is the Gaussian approximation using the second derivative, and in red the actual probabilities that I sampled. And yeah, it's pretty close. At the lower values, it can have a relative error of 50%, but it's at 10 to the minus 10. So now the interesting part with whole history rating is how can we expand this constant rating, which is static for a longer time, and have it changing over time. So first we need some kind of model. How do we model the rating changing over time? We do this, we model it as a Wiener process. What this means is that at each time step, we add a normal distributed random variable. And over time, you then get this confidence interval that grows with the square root of time. The variance grows linearly with time, as you can see in the model. And there I plotted three possible realizations of this Wiener process, how it can look. And this is already a pretty good model. And one extension that I did to this is to add a second dimension, which not only includes time, but also the number of games played. Or to be more precise, the weight the player had in these games. But in 1v1s, it's the number of games played. And by adding this, we get the effect that you have with ELO, that rating changes more when you're active. Because when players play a lot, they're expected to change in skill a lot. But also over time, they're expected to change in skill. Okay. So now we need to expand the Bayesian model a bit. We can assume for every day that the player plays on, that we have for that day, we can use the static model. So now we have these days for which we can solve, but we need to connect them somehow. And we do that using the model I just presented. So we say the likelihood of a rating changing depends on how much time has passed between 2 days. And then we use a normal distribution. So here you can see the normal distribution. And the sigma is directly the square root of the time and the number of games played. So the prior remains a win and a loss on the first day. So we just need the prior once. And then we connect each day to the previous and the following day using this normal distribution, depending on how much time passed between the days. Now, how do we solve this? We can still use Newton's method, but now we have an n-dimensional problem because we have the vector of days for each player, and we want to find out for every day that the player played in what is the most likely rating. So we can take the formula we had before for the Bayesian likelihood for every day, take the gradient and the Hessian, and then we get the Newton's method again, but this time n-dimensionally. This might look a bit computationally expensive because we now have a matrix that we need to invert, but every day only depends on the previous and the next day. So the matrix only has the diagonal, the superdiagonal, and the subdiagonal, and we can do the LU factorization in linear time. So this is still cheap to calculate, and we can find the covariance matrix also just by inverting the Hessian. So now we've solved the problem for multiple days. I hope that was mostly clear to everybody. I went through it a bit quick. So let's have a look at the results. First, I would like to present you how this is implemented on the website for the game. So let's go over there now. Here you can see the website and go to the rating statistics. You can add some players here. Then you can see their rating history. And one thing that is really specific about whole history rating is how it can optimize independent of where the player started. So this player average plan has a starting ELO of 2200. And this might seem a bit weird because now we have a player who starts really, really high and then drops lower. So he's probably not playing for his first time. And actually we can see what was his previous account and also plot that. And now you can see how he played previously on this different account, which started at a much more normal rating of 1800 and then slowly increased. Then he switched accounts to a new account and then started increasing in rating again. So, and let's also, one more thing to look at is just predicting some 1v1 games for comparison to ELO. So I just took 50,000 games from the 0k matchmaker and ran ELO with two different k constants on it. Usually the constant used is 32 or even 20 because players don't like ELO being varying too much between matches. But for more accuracy, it's usually better to use a higher k-constant. As you can see here, it has a much higher score. I've also used the binary logarithm for scoring. What this does is it measures the entropy and it gives a score, and I added one, so it gives a score of 0 for a rating system that always chooses a random outcome, and a score of 1 for a rating system that chooses perfectly, and minus infinity for one that chooses wrongly, completely wrong. And yeah, you can see pretty clearly how WHR, as given in the paper, already way outperforms ELO, and I did some modifications, like supporting FFA and teams that I didn't measure here, and the other modification was the, to add games as for the Wiener process, and this slightly improves it again. You can also see that WHR is a lot slower, but I think this is pretty much an advantage at this point because we have so much computing power available, and what we're using ELO is a system that's way too simple pretty much for modeling player. Yeah, I'm sure you'll have some questions about this. So that's mostly it. I'm open for your questions.
Well, thank you very much. So this time, please don't be so shy. Don't hesitate to ask questions.
I've got a question. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, please.
Yeah, so obviously the runtime of the algorithm is dependent or is linear in the number of games played, right?
So, yes, to update the rating of one player, it's linear in the number of games this player has played.
Yeah. So does this pose a problem for, or could you imagine this posing a problem for certain kinds of games where people can play hundreds of thousands of matches, or does this never pose an issue?
Well, there are some optimizations I had to do even now, and that is after each game, I don't optimize the entire system for all players, but I only optimize the ratings for that player who played in the game. This means that if you have a player who played 100,000 games, it runs linear in this 100,000 games, but it doesn't have to update it for all players. And this is also what I used in the evaluation, and as you can see, it's still good enough. So as soon as you cross the threshold where linear time is no longer quick enough, then it becomes too slow. So after maybe 100 million games per player, you can't use it anymore.
All right, thanks.
Mm-hmm. Any other question? So one question from my side. So the fundamental assumption is that it's, say, the outcome of games played by two players is normally distributed depending on the relative strength of the players. Is this correct?
It's the logistic distribution.
Logistically distributed, because this wasn't, probably missed something. So
yeah, it didn't.
Distribution.
That was the assumption in the Bradley-Terry model entirely in the beginning. That's also what ELO uses. And I didn't mention it, yes.
Okay, then it's clear. All right, so thanks again for this presentation about the very important topic of data assimilation in a particular setting. Data assimilation is also important for many fields of science when you collect data over time and then want to adjust some model. All right, so let's clap.